back there making noises, right?
When Emil was around, Emil was the percussionist that every percussionist knew about. I mean, because it was a known fact. I mean, if you wanted the best percussionist in town, you talked about Emil Richards. So this was the first session, probably, I think, with Emil, was in 1976 on the Rocky movie. So I made the mistake of walking back into the percussion section.
Don't ever do that.
These guys are doing three sessions a day.
Yep.
Wow. Yeah.
They're doing jingles. Guys are crazy.
Yeah.
And if you were a hot composer, you were crazy too. So I never said no to anything. The Rocky movie was a $25,000 package deal. Two guys turned it down before me, and I had 1 3-hour session. And we were rushing. There was no video. There was no a projection because it cost money. And everything was take one. Maybe take two, and that was it. Move to the next, take one, take two. And even the director was saying, am I gonna see anything? And he goes, no, absolutely not. We're out of here in 3 hours.
It's two, right?
Oh, nice.
But do you remember, did you use these like a Karate Kid?
Well, I did Karate Kid, yeah.
Do you remember these being on the stage at all?
Oh, yeah. And they have to be written for in a way that they can be mic'd and have the expansion of sound. It's just like what a piano does to an orchestra. Because when you start to hear the piano, everything gets smaller. So these guys, yeah, to really lead them, you have to have music around them. And at some point, the music has to stop. And these guys have to take the stage.
You know what's funny about rub rods? Everyone tells me, like composers included, they always thought that was an electronic sound. They always think that's an electronic sound. No one knows that's ever... Yeah.
It blends in there, like you can barely tell. Like it just like until you know the sound.
Yeah.
They're all over all three Karate Kids.
You could have a rub rod choir. Bass rub rods.
Oh, nice.
That's
people in this kind of suits jumping up. That's the same thing with all this stuff, you know. You're looking for that one interesting thing that's going to catch somebody's ear and remember that you wrote it.
Emil found and created so many instruments and so many sounds that were never documented. They didn't even end up in the manuscripts. Sometimes they did, but they were like called for, but no one knows what that thing is. Emil's thing for us about having these was the middle finger always had to be up. I'm not kidding. This was his rule.
His ears tuned to the context of what the music is doing. There were times when I'd go, you hear the mix and you go, what's going on here?
Mm-hmm.
What's it? Emil, what is that? I only hear French horns.
Are you talking about like the slow glissando thing?
There no, saying? Yeah, no, no, I know.
Was that his bass? Was it that or was his bass slide whistle? I'm like interrogating you.
No, I know. What year is that?
Oh, this is like 40 years ago. What's the problem?
Where were you on the night and did you use a bass slide whistle?
I'm saying. Because he would come up with something that would be interesting in the context of what you're doing. He knows the degree of timbre that he wants to use and what frequency is going to cut through. So you write his fill.
Right.
And then you say, now work with it. The rhythm section has to be free enough to be creative.
Did you use slap-a-phone? Do you remember using the slap-a-phone?
What made that sound? Yeah.
Is it Trancelos?
Sounds like Beltre, I don't know.
I don't know, it might have been Beltre, you're right.
It's a wash of sound, and you go, Beltre.
Well, because, you know, you clue into the things you know.
Yeah, right, like, you're zeroing in on
that.
But then I wanted to show you the Trancelos. Do you remember the Trancelos?
Yes.
This is what you used in more than one film. But when I was hearing some of the things in the scores, unless they might have messed around with the mix, but I was hearing more of a soft attack.
For sure.
Oh, I got that one, right? That was the time when we used the Super Bowl a lot.
Oh, you used Super Bowl on? Transforms?
Well, everything.
Super Bowl was great. You, because Emil had a lot of interest in like Indian music, gamelan.
Oh, yeah.
Did you ever try to play a djembe?
We have his over there.
But you know how it's laid out.
Emil played with Stravinsky also on his birthday concert. He told me that Stravinsky had a cymbalum in his bedroom when he was growing up.
Oh, yeah.
Emil said to Stravinsky, this lays out really nicely on this instrument.
Oh, yeah. The beast. And Emil played it. Just tuning it is a miracle.
Yeah.
In different cases, he would say, even on a session, if you ever have use for something like this, and he'd pull out one of these and bang it, you know, go up and... I got this in Borneo and, you know.
Yeah.
And you put that in your ear. So in the back of your head, you go, oh, that would be an interesting sound. Sometimes, somewhere. Gotta have one of those.
So my overall arching question is, in your opinion, what was Emil's influence in film music?
Well, in any music, first of all, he was a superior musician, which really wouldn't count as much if he wasn't such a good guy. A bad guy who's a superior musician is going to work and you will put up with his whatever. But this is the sweetest man on the planet. And he's this fine musician. So he was loved by everyone. Each section has a couple of, and each period of time has a person that is stands out. Well, in this period of time, when Emil was around, Emil was the percussionist that every percussionist knew about. Came from New England, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Along with Cipriano and
Joe Picaro.
I mean, the two of them.
They're buddies.
Big buddies. Yeah. And on every session, I mean, that was in the percussion section. He knew everything. He did everything. And he was a wonderful guy.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you, too.
This is so fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Be well.
Bye. Bye. Drive safely, thanks, okay?
Out so far and wide because his instruments are used in so many places.
To be able to have percussionists who understand story, that's something that you only get here.
These sounds more as textures and less as novelty.
Definitely, you know, and you never want something that is going to feel untruthful or feel like you're aiming for kitsch.
Composer was smart enough to understand, let me just take out everything that I've written and just use Emil's microtonal bells for the main title.